والله يدعو إلى دار السلام ويهدي من يشاء إلى صراط مستقيم.
الله نزل أحسن الحديث كتابا متشابها مثانية تقشعر منه جلود الذين يخشون ربهم ثم تلين جلودهم وقلوبهم إلى ذكر الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I welcome you to another episode of our series, Understanding the Quran. This is your host, Jasser Qazi. In today's episode, we're going to discuss the names of the Quran and the descriptions of the Quran in the Quran and the Sunnah. Allah Azza wa Jal has given a number of names of the Quran. And by understanding these names, we appreciate better how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to view this book. Of course, as we said in our last episode, the primary name of the Qur'an is the word Qur'an itself. And we explained that the meaning of this word is the recitation. And this word occurs over 70 times in the Qur'an. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses it as the primary reference to His book. But there is another name which occurs almost as frequently or maybe even more than this name. And that is the name Al-Kitab. In fact, when we open up the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, أَلِفْ لَمْ مِيمْ ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ. This is the kitab in which there is no doubt. So one of the names of the Qur'an is Al-Kitab. And the meaning of Al-Kitab is that which is written down, that which is preserved in writing, i.e. the book. So the Qur'an is that which is recited, and the kitab is that which is written. And the two put together demonstrate that the Qur'an has been preserved both by recitation and by preservation in the mushafs. And they are complementary names. The Qur'an is meant to be read and it is meant to be recited. The Qur'an is meant to be preserved in the hearts by memorization and by the writings of men. So the Qur'an and the kitab are complementary names, the recitation and the writing down. Another description of the Qur'an is Al-Furqan. For example, in the beginning of Surah Al-Furqan, Allah says, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي نَزَّلَ الْفُرْقَانَ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ. Exalted and blessed is He who sent down the Furqan to His servant. So Allah calls the Qur'an, He calls it Al-Furqan. What is the meaning of Al-Furqan? Al-Furqan means that which separates, i.e. truth from falsehood. So the Qur'an separates guidance from misguidance. When you study the Qur'an, you believe in the Qur'an, you recite the Qur'an, you will have a criterion from which and through which and by which to separate truth from falsehood, good from evil. Of the names of the Qur'an is Al-Dhikr. And this is a very common name. وَإِنَّهُ لَذِكْرٌ لَكَ وَلِقَوْمِكَ. This is a dhikr for you and your people. And a dhikr means an admonition, a remembrance or a narrative. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this Qur'an makes you contemplate, it makes you think, it makes you contemplate the purpose of life and where you are going and what the hereafter is. So it is an admonition and a reminder. Yet another name of the Qur'an is Tanzil. And Tanzil means that which has come down or that which has been revealed. And this name also occurs many, many times in the Qur'an. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّهُ لَتَنْزِيلُ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. This is the revelation from the Lord of the worlds. This is a tanzil. And of the implications of the name tanzil is that this book is not an average book. It is not a book like other books. It is not a mortal book. It is a divine book. There is a direct connection between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala via this book. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, I have sent it down, I have revealed it. So it is a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. تَنْزِيلٌ مِّن رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. It is a revelation from the Lord of all of the worlds. The Qur'an also describes itself with many beautiful adjectives. For example, the Qur'an calls itself the mercy of Allah and the blessings of Allah. In one verse Allah says, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا. Allah says, say, by the blessings and the mercy of Allah. Rejoice because of these things. And the scholars have interpreted this to mean the blessings and mercy of Allah is none other than the Qur'an itself. This is the book, this is the Qur'an, this is the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah calls the fadl and the rahmah. In yet another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls the Qur'an a maw'idha, which is an admonition, a reflection. And he calls it a shifa, which means that which cures. So the Qur'an is a maw'idha, which means it is an admonition, it makes you think and contemplate. It makes you scared of the punishment of Allah. It makes you eager to enter into Jannah. And it is also a shifa, which means it is a cure. Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. O mankind, there has come to you an admonition from your Lord and a cure for that which is in the hearts, and a mercy and a guidance for all of mankind and for the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also calls the Qur'an a mercy for all of mankind. For example, Allah says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. We reveal of the Qur'an that which is a cure and a mercy for all of the believers. So the Qur'an is a rahmah, the Qur'an is a mercy. Likewise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Qur'an as being the best of all speech. Allahu nazzala ahsana al-hadithi kitaban mutashabiha. Allah has revealed the best of all speech, a book whose parts help one another and complement one another and aid one another in understanding the entire book. So the Quran is a mercy, the Quran is a light. In one verse Allah describes the Quran as waqad anzalna ilaykum nuran mubina. We have revealed to you the clear light. And this light, Allah says, is used to guide mankind from the darknesses of ignorance to the light of knowledge, from the darknesses of worshipping other than Allah to the light of worshipping Allah alone, the light of Tawheed. Likewise, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam described the status of the Qur'an and the blessings of those who recite it and act upon it in numerous ahadith. And it would take us many, many hours to narrate all of these ahadith. And in fact, many of the classical scholars of Islam wrote treatises only on this particular subject, the subject of the blessings of the Qur'an as described by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And of the most succinct hadith in this regard is the hadith in Bukhari, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best of you, the best amongst you, are those who first they learn the Qur'an and then they teach it to others. They learn the Qur'an and then they teach it to others. Likewise, the Prophet ﷺ told us, this book, the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will use it to raise up some people, i.e. into Jannah, and to lower and debase others, i.e. into the fire of hell. So the Prophet ﷺ told us the Qur'an will be used to raise up some people and lower others. In another hadith, in a very similar meaning, the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Qur'anu hujjatun laka aw alayk. That the Qur'an will be used as an evidence for you on the Day of Judgment, or it will be used as an evidence against you on the Day of Judgment. There is no middle ground. The Qur'an is either for you or against you. And we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes the Qur'an for us on the Day of Judgment. In a beautiful hadith, the Prophet ﷺ also said, Abshiru, be happy, rejoice. For verily, this Qur'an that you have, one part of it, it is as if it is in your hands. And the other part, it is as if it is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a direct link between you and Allah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, hold on to it fast, means strongly, for you will never be misguided, you will never be destroyed if you hold on to it. Likewise, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen certain people on this earth. He has blessed certain people on this earth, and the people that he has blessed, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, they are the Ahlul Qur'ani wa khassatuhu. They are the people of the Qur'an and the privileged people who have understood and memorized it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also told us of a very beautiful parable, a very beautiful metaphor. And he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given an example for you to think about. And that example is that of a man on a road. And he is going straight on this road. And there are curtains on the side of this road which have chambers and doors. And sometimes he wants to lift that curtain and go away from the road. But a voice at the top of the road, at the head of the road, tells him, do not lift the curtains, come straight forward. And the Prophet ﷺ explained the hadith and he said, this road is the Sirat al-Mustaqim, the straight path that leads to Jannah. And these chambers with covers on them are the limits of Allah that you're not allowed to go into, that which is prohibited in our religion. And the voice at the top of the road, the voice at the end of the road is the Qur'an guiding you straight forward. The Qur'an is telling you, come. So if you listen to the Qur'an, you will not go right and left, you will go straight. And as you go straight, that will cause you to enter Jannah. And so the Prophet ﷺ strongly encouraged us to read the Qur'an and memorize the Qur'an and understand the Qur'an. He said that on the Day of Judgment, the Qur'an will come and testify for you on your behalf. And his testimony will be accepted. The Prophet ﷺ said, whoever puts the Qur'an in front of him, meaning as his guide, then the Qur'an will lead him to Jannah. And whoever throws it behind him, meaning he ignores the Qur'an, then the Qur'an will drag him to the fire of hell. And the Prophet ﷺ also said, I am commanding you to recite the Qur'an, for verily you will be recited for every word that you read. And I'm not saying that alif, lam, mim counts as one word. Rather, alif counts as a word, and lam counts as a word, and mim counts as a word. Whatever recitation you do, the Qur'an will reward you. Allah Azza wa Jalla will reward you for reciting the Qur'an. And in a very beautiful hadith that really encourages us to memorize the Qur'an, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the person who is a companion of the Qur'an, means he always recites the Qur'an and acts upon it and believes in it. The person who is the sahib of the Qur'an, means he's always with the Qur'an, will be brought on the Day of Judgment. And he will be told, recite. And as he recites, he will go higher and higher and higher. Until he has recited all that he knows of the Qur'an. In one version, it says, he will be told to recite as you used to recite in this world. And he will continue to recite as he used to recite in this world until his place in Jannah is equivalent to the amount of Qur'an inside of him. The more he's memorized, the higher his place in Jannah. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, such as the Book of Allah, as described by the Qur'an and as described by the Sunnah, should we not memorize it? Should we not recite it? Should we not ponder over it? Should we not believe in it? With this, we come to the conclusion of today's episode. I hope to see you next time. Until then, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allah nazzala ahsan al-hadith kitaban mutashabiha كتابا متشابها مثانية تقشعر منه جلود الذين يخشون ربهم ثم تلين جلودهم وقلوبهم إلى ذكر الله